Good evening, metal faithful and social justice warriors everywhere. This is the Metal Hammer. This is the Metal Hammer of Doom. And you know what? You know what that gets a come here, horsey. Thank you, Mr. Ed. This is the Metal Hammer of Doom, and I am your host, the Man Data Reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Rattledge. And we've got a throwback session for the ages here. We're going straight out the 70s with the new sound of The Sword, Used Future. A little bit of stoner rock for your ass tonight. Of course, I am not alone to deliberate these proceedings. I am joined by the second chair. He was absent last week because he was helping nuns cross the street and reading to school children. At least that's the memo I've been given to read by the censors. Ladies and gentlemen, the formerly fun, the Metal Coop, Robert Cooper. How do you do, sir?
Hey, I am still very fun.
Yeah, tell it to the judge.
Hey, I will make rape and sodomy jokes when I want to.
Okay.
It's just unfortunate, because now I can't do it at work.
Well, we'll get back to that in just a second. But my partner in crime these days, the man that's helping me poke the bears and the badges, ladies and gentlemen, the disapproving dad and the host of Source Material in his own right, you love him, you think he's a racist too, ladies and gentlemen, Jesse Starcher, how do you do, sir?
Oh, my goodness. So, Fun Time Coop went and became Nun Time Coop.
That's right. And you can take that any way you like it. N-U-N or N-O-N-E.
Oh, wow. Well, I'll tell you, things have changed in the past couple of weeks then. My goodness. Well, you know, I am glad. I'm glad to be here on a, you know, we're a couple weeks after America Cacant and Judas Priest. I really hope we don't make anybody mad that likes the swords. The swords awful laid back, you know. They're a laid back kind of bunch of guys, and I hope their fan base is just the same. But hell, you never know. Let's see what the episode brings.
Listen,
you know
I'm just
funny.
I'm gonna continue to just be me and say what I'm gonna say, and if I piss somebody off, I mean, such is life in the big city. There's 6 billion of us on the planet, I think. I'm going to insult one or two people in the process of just being me. That's just life. What do you have to say for yourself, Coop?
You know what I have to say? So I was looking at the 2018 metal releases, and what did I find? Goat Tunnel.
Oh, yeah?
Ronnie Adams' seventh favorite band.
That's right.
It is, right behind Goat Moon.
And Goat Penis. You can't forget Goat
and
Penis.
John Cougar Concentration Camp.
You know what? Beat me to it on that one. Hey, so you saw that? So you asked me, you know, like, hey, Rattledge, let me pick some albums here to review since this is a partnership, not a dictatorship. And I said, absolutely. Except we're booked pretty much straight through August. But go ahead and send me your list. What did you think of the list of stuff that I have picked out for the month leading all the way through August? Other than you hate Godsmack.
I really hate Godsmack. Actually, there were some of them. What was one of them? There was one of them on there that I was like, I wanted to review that. That's great. Amorphis, that's right.
Yeah, well, I knew that. And I knew that the last Amorphis album was really, really good. So I was excited to put that on there.
Every Amorphis album's really good.
What I've discovered is there's actually a couple of covers albums coming out this year. There's a Satyricon covers album coming out. They just announced a Burn the Priest reunion/covers album that's coming out. There's
cover album that we need to review by a metal band. And what do? They cover anime theme songs.
Okay.
And like old 80s cartoons.
Is this a new release for this year, or just this has been out for a while now?
No, it's this year. Hold on, let me pull out my spreadsheet.
All right, well, here's the deal. Whenever we review it, it's going to be in the month of October, because October is Halloween, and Halloween means all covers all month long. So every week in the month of October, I want to do a different covers album from this year. So we got to
be perfect.
Yeah, so save it for then. We're going to do the new Mystic
Trick or Treat.
Is it really? Awesome, perfect. Okay. Yeah. Let me. Let's send me the link at some point, and I'll get it on the schedule. But yeah, we're gonna do the burn that priest. We're gonna do the Burn the Priest covers album. We'll do the Trick or Treat one that you just suggested. Devil Driver is doing like an album of all country covers. Satyricon, like I said, Mystic Prophecy. Jesse knows what I'm talking about. Give me that hot stuff, baby. Hot stuff, baby, tonight. So we're going to get all that in the month of October. But let's deal with the month of March. That is The Sword. Used Future, Baby Dolls. Came out, I believe, last Friday, and it's already... I got to give The New Machine Head another listen. We might need to redo that show, seeing as the soundboard went kaflooey midway through it. But other than possibly Machine Head and definitely Rumahoy, this Sword album is probably my favorite of the year so far. It's no Baby Metal. All right, I'm good. Wait, hang on. Hang on.
Come here, horsey.
Come here, horsey. No, but seriously, it's... I know that you're stuck on the orphan land, and you know, last week Jesse got his pants wet for the Judas Priest, but I'm telling
good
you,
shit.
Man,
good shit.
This new Sword album rose to the top of my charts, the Mark Rattledge charts. Jesse, you were a little slow to be turned on by the new Sword album. You were a little cold. It took you a while to get your motor running, to get warmed up. Why is that, sir? Because I know you're a big Sword fan.
Yeah, well, I'm going to beat Robert Cooper to probably, maybe, the history of how I became a Sword fan. But I'll probably let him step in and tell everybody where I heard my first ever Sword song. Robert
ooh,
Cooper,
ooh,
where
know,
was that?
I
where
know.
Was it at?
It was Guitar Hero 2.
Everybody take a drink.
Yes, indeed. So I fell in love with these guys. Loved playing that song over and over and over. Which
so
I believe was three Freya?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
No, did three have Freya? I thought it was two.
Okay, I think it's three. I could be wrong.
Google this.
Do it. Give us an answer. But I loved playing that song, and I loved the way it sounded, and that was one of those songs that made me go, I want to hear some more from this band just to see what I think of them. And
yep, Guitar Hero 2.
It was two? Wow.
Yep.
And that was Freya?
Yep.
All right, then. So,
damn, I'm good.
You are, dude. I swore it was three, too. But, so I played it and played it and played it. Loved it. And then I wanted more. I wanted more. So I dove into the archives of YouTube and I think, you know, just the old torrents to find out what did these guys have under their belt. And I listened to, I think... what was at the time Gods of the Earth and Age of Winters.
Oh, I love that album.
Yes, both those albums have got some great heavy shit on there. And I was like, okay, I kind of like these guys and was really curious as to what was going to be coming out next. Now this was, so I got into them before Warp Riders hit. And
I love that album.
When Warp Riders hit, my mind was blown. It was heavy and it is, I think, that's one of the few albums I actually have downloaded to my iPhone. Okay, I've got Spotify, I could do all whatever, but I've actually downloaded that album to where I could listen to it. Warp Riders was one of my favorites, and it's good top to bottom. So I immediately become a fan. Then, let's see, we go into Apocryphon, which came out in 2012. Again, more of that heavy stuff. There's some great stuff on that album, and there might be a couple songs I could do without, but we're still keeping up with the heavy.
You know they released that album on cassette, right?
Did they really?
Oh, yeah. That's when I used to write. That's when I was running the column, and I thought that was the funniest thing ever.
Wow. Then we have to wait 3 years, and we get into High Country in 2015, and now things take a turn. Things take a very weird turn for me when it comes to my enjoyment of The Sword, because I was like, oh, there is some stuff on here that really is not that heavy. It was not that heavy. And as a matter of fact, they changed their sound a good bit to where it was, there was a lot more synth, it was a lot more laid back, and it felt, I don't know, just kind of lackluster. So I was really trepidistic. That's not even a word, but I'll call it that.
Trepidatious.
Pardon you?
Maybe. I was trepidatious. Is that a word? That's a word, right?
Yes, that is a
there
word.
There we go. Okay. I was worried about this this new album coming up. And yes, I was lukewarm on it. Now, this is my did you say 50 words or less? Because clearly I've gone over that. But Used Future had me worried because I didn't know what we were going to get. And my first listen was more like, okay, this is more the stuff like High Country brought us. Maybe even a little bit more tame. But as we go through the album, you'll find that I really, really have warmed up to this album a lot. So, Coop, you know, I'll turn it over to you. Tell us about The Sword, man.
You know, the pen is mightier than it.
Oh, hey, look at that.
And it's the thing that lost Sean Connery Jeopardy.
Fuck you, Trebek.
Your mother. Shut up. Yeah, so yeah, The Sword, I discovered them through Guitar Hero, of course. Who doesn't?
Take a drink.
I knew it wasn't on TV. Because
two-thirds of this show usually does.
Yeah, either that or my friend Nick, who's in town this weekend. I still haven't had him on this podcast.
Why he isn't on the podcast, I have no idea.
It's because I said, hey, let's do... He's like, if you ever do a Sabbath review, I'll be on it.
That's not happening anytime soon.
We're going back and getting, what was it, 13? Let's do that again.
Nope.
We'll re-review it. Bring Sean Garmer back. Love Sean. But anywho, so, yeah. Age of Winters, Gods of this Earth, Warp Riders, fucking fantastic. Apocryphon, there were some standout songs, but I don't feel like it was as strong as a showing. Then you got the High Country and Low Country, and I'm like, I ever tell you I don't like Country the Sword? Because it was all right. It had some bright spots. It had some groove to it, but
I wasn't thrilled with it, to be honest with you.
I felt like they really kind of lost their way. And this album, it's a weird mix of both worlds. Like, there's some interesting, some really groovy, sludgy sort of metal songs that are in here. But it's a lot of more atmospheric music, and I like it. I like it. It's one of those albums that, like, I feel like rewards repeat listens, and it has a real good hooks in it.
All right. Let's get started here. Now, let me just tell you right off the bat. I love this whole album, but here's the deal. I'm not playing the really, really short. Like the prelude is only 30 seconds long. There's really no point in me playing a 15 seconds of a 30-second song. Same thing with Intermezzo. It's a minute and 30 seconds. There are some fairly lengthy... what do you call it?
Instrumental tracks?
Thank you. I couldn't think of the word. Instrumental tracks. I will play those. Those are worth playing. But we are going to skip Prelude, and we are going to skip Intermezzo. We'll probably close out, though, with a little bit of that reprise. In the meantime, like I said, let's get started with the first proper track of the evening. This is Deadly Nightshade.
Crazy.
Jesse Starcher. Can you dig, Jesse Starcher, can you dig that 70s vibe, baby?
Indeed. I like this track. It's okay. I think this is one of their singles that they released, I believe. I could be wrong, but I remember hearing this song I'm pretty sure I heard it before the album dropped. And so I was kind of familiar with it going into the album. In the first listening, it's all right. I mean, it's not as heavy as I want it to be, but I think one of the first YouTube comments, yeah, I read those. One of the first YouTube comments, one of the first YouTube comments that I read was that, you know, the Sword has they've made their decision as to the way they're going to go down in music history, I believe. So the fact that this isn't as heavy as I want it to be, I think that's because the Sword is evolving. We're watching an evolving band go into a sound that they like to do. And this is probably one of the more, I'd say, fast-paced tracks off this album. But it's still decent. It's okay.
I love this track. I'm having a hard time deciding what's my favorite track on here between this one, Sea of Green, Don't Get Too Comfortable. I mean, they're all so good. Yeah, there's a lot of really bomb tracks on here. It's just another funky radical bomb track. But, you know, as you were talking, isn't this the conversation that was had about Clutch like 10 years ago, you know, in between, say, like Elephant Riders, Jam Room, and Blast Tyrant, you know, that, mm-hmm. and then right on into From Beale Street to Oblivion.
Beale Street, yep.
You know, where it was just like, wow, what happened to Rats Over the Dishes? What happened?
Yeah.
they went from a shogun named Marcus to Bang 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 Bang, Vominos.
You look at Pitchfork. And you compare that first album that is just heavier than balls, and then you look at that and compare it to Beale Street or something like that. It's starkly different.
Sure.
But you at some point as a listener have to make a decision as to whether you're going to stick with this band and if you like what they sound like now.
You know, again, I brought up Clutch because, I mean, there's the evolution of, you know, a band that was, you know, kind, you know, that had a more hardcore vibe to it in the beginning and then really defined what we've come to know as stoner rock. You know, so the Sword started out as more crunchy, more gritty, and has really sort of evolved into this more laid back 70s vibe, like I said before. I mean, this feels like late 70s guitar rock. Mm-hmm. Like they should have all been standing on top of like a big old Chevy, you know, wearing baseball shirts, playing in the sunlight. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
With big ass glasses and bell bottom pants, baby. You know, I love that feel to it. It might just be, you know, my age showing or whatever, but not everything has to sound like, you know, Pantera. And I know it sounds weird from the guy that says everything has to sound like Pantera, but. But I don't know.
Pantera, this beer is warm.
But yeah, man, we hear a lot of stuff on the Metal Hammer of Doom, and, you know, and we use the word samezy, and we try not to use it. We try to give bands their due, but a lot of stuff doesn't stand out. You know, like once we're done listening to it, I immediately delete it from my Spotify playlists, and I don't think about it anymore until maybe like the end of the year when we're like, well, what do we like? This one has gotten multiple plays, and it's been in my head. And I'll tell you, like, I go for the nightly walks now, and you should see me, man. I'm, like, bebopping in the street. I'm like, yeah. I'm trying to walk for exercise. Meanwhile, there might as well have been a camera in front of me. I'm, like, you know, throwing my hands up, and I'm like, yeah, deadly nightshade. You know, I walked in the house, and I've got my earphones on, so my wife can't hear what I'm listening to. My daughter can't hear, but I'm, like, dancing through the house. I'm, like, grabbing them and dancing with them. You know, I'm doing a whole thing. I'm stealing a lot of my moves from Grease Lightning, from the movie Grease, you know, and it's just so good. It's the rhythm gets me, Robert Cooper. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? The rhythm in Used Future, the album gets me from head to toe. It's the groove that makes my booty move. You pick it up what I'm putting down?
Oh, hell yeah. Like changing a pit, man.
Jesus. So what are your thoughts, sir? Deadly Nightshade, go.
It is not quite as good as the Megadeth song of Deadly
Thank
Nightshade.
You. Yes. I can't. Dude, I first saw the title of this song, and that's immediately what I went to, because I can remember Deadly Nightshade being so memorable off that album for some strange reason.
Deadly Nightshade.
Which is funny. I think both songs are about a woman. So take that for what it's worth. Go ahead, Coop.
I mean, I did dig this song, though. It's a fun song. It's got a good groove to it. Almost has like a lumbering verse in a way, like it's almost slowly pulled out of the singer, if it makes sense. It's not usually quick. It's almost like they're pulling the words out of him, and I like that.
Mm-hmm.
I dig the song. I feel like it's really catchy. I like that it's heavier, because I do feel like we're kind of missing out on some of the heavier tracks that they used to offer.
I'm not missing it, I'll be honest with you. There's enough groove on this. There's enough vibe. How many times did I say groove and vibe in this one episode? There's enough bass in these that I'm not necessarily... I think on the Metal Hammer of Doom, it's nice to kind of take a break and hear something that isn't quite as metal as we're used to dealing with on here. That's my opinion. Jesse and I did a video reaction to this next one. It's called Twilight Sunrise. So here is some of my thoughts on that one. I feel like if there's one track that they threw together to make the old Sword fans happy, the Jesse Sword fans, if you will, is this one. It's probably
the Fire Hero Sword fans.
It's probably like the heaviest one on the album by a fair stretch. And it, you know, and is it heavy? No, not by any classic definition of the worm or the word. You know, the term, but you know, by comparison to some of this other stuff, yeah, probably. I mean, this is probably as close as we're going to get to the old Sword on this album. Would you agree, Jess?
Yeah, this is something that probably would have fit on Apocryphon, I believe. This is one where I'm singing along with it and enjoying it. I love kind of diving into their lyrics, because what you see the Sword talk about a lot of times is humanity in some shape or form, or humanity's relation to religion, and you know, and the choices that humanity makes. I think when we get to Don't Get Too Comfortable, I think that is a, not only is it a great song, but it is a great commentary as well. So that is one of the strong suits, I believe, that the Sword brings, and they are great at writing lyrics, in my opinion, and putting a wonderful song to it. So when you listen to a Sword song, usually if you're paying attention to what's being said, you either come away with something to think about, or you know, you're just impressed with the fact that he put something like this together to kind of try and tell a story. So yeah, Twilight Sunrise, I dig it. Coop?
I like that it hit the accelerator at that, at a certain point in the song. You're like, all right, this is good, and then it's like, boom, fucking goes like three times as fast. It's fucking cool. I love that shit. I know. This is the song they wrote to appease me. They're like, yes, you Robert Cooper. That's right. The song's for you. And I'm like, oh, my God, they're singing to me.
Oh! And Robert Cooper threw his dirty underwear at him.
Oh, my.
Oh, I think they'd probably throw me out just because of the smell.
All right. We're going to keep... I know Robert's got a hot date tonight, so we're going to keep the party moving here. Here's my one complaint about the album, and this is as good a time as any to bring this up. I feel like it was really backloaded with some real great groovy music. It's front-loaded. I mean, it's like you have the instrumental prelude, and you have two pretty solid tracks, then another instrumental, then a really great song, probably if not the best on here, then the second best on here by a long stretch, then another instrumental, and then boom, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 tracks in a row, none of which I believe are instrumental, all really solid, all really good, really, really good. It's like, it's a weird way to construct this album. Here's what I'm talking about, Baby Dolls. This is The Wild Sky. All right. Gentlemen, what's our thoughts here? Jesse, you got a little bit of an instrumental, a little bit of a break. What do you think?
I thought about your comments on the construction of the album itself. There's a feeling that I get like if I was at a concert, this would be the guy's set list. It's time to take a little bit of a break. Well, give the vocalist a little break. Turn the band loose. It's important that I tell everybody that I kind of agree with you when it comes to the fact that they're front loaded with, or this is, there's a lot more instrumentals than what you normally see in an album. And I just got done complimenting the lyrics and how they've come up with and tell a great story sometimes or make you think. That is something that's missing from this album. I don't get all that great stuff that makes me go, oh man, that's a good song. Listen to the story that's being told. You don't get that with instrumentals. You just get to sit back and smoke your joint and let things be. Let me
quick add that. I mean, I want to let you continue, and I want Robert to weigh in here. But the one thing, that one resounding remark I want to make about this album is that if I like to get high, this is the album to get baked to. Like, if
agreed.
You're going to get baked to any modern rock album, this is the one.
Yeah, I agree. It's laid back. I mean, there's no other better term, in my opinion, to say that the sword, the guys that brought you, was it Burrell's Blade? I can't even pronounce it right. But, all these great, heavy, throw your fist up in the air songs that you just, oh, hell yeah. And then now you just can sit back and watch them morph into this retro stoner band. And yeah, it's something to just chill and listen to.
Yeah, Coop? this is very psychedelica.
Agreed.
What about me, some psychedelica? Or is it psychedelia?
It's a band name.
Oh. it's a good question to ask ourselves sometimes.
Or the Google machine.
Or the Wayback machine.
Oh,
no, we're definitely
of the Wayback machine.
We're definitely in the Wayback machine.
Yeah, that's right. Musically, I would agree. I don't think, well, it would be a good band. I've never smoked weed or gotten high. I don't know. I think some Pentagram would be pretty fucking good for that. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. It's good groovy, doomy stuff. Or some Electric Wizard. That's just, that. Or Earth. No, Earth would definitely be number one. Angels of Darkness, Demons of Light. Yeah, that's what I used to write music, write papers to all day. It's fucking groovy. It's even got gospel influences in some pieces. Interesting stuff. Anywho, I really dug this instrumental. It was really engaging. Kept me wanting more. And yeah, I dug it. Good shit, man.
All right, let's keep the party moving. We're gonna skip intermezzo. We're gonna go right to, like I said, you know, as far as songs that really got into my bones and moved me.
Oh, get ready! Get ready!
You know, I was really stuck on Deadly Nightshade there for a bit, and then Jesse's like, "Give Sea of Green another listen," and I can't get this song out of my head, out of my bones, out of my heart, out of my feet. It's all up in me. It's in me. All right, here we go. This is Sea of Green.
Thank you.
Oh my god, 1-2, oh my god. Lay back on the hood, back against the windshield, and stare into the sunlight, smoke a bowl, and let your problems just soar into the atmosphere. Let the colors of the world swirl around you and take you to Nirvana. Not the band. So good. How awesome is that song?
Dude, let me tell you. The beginning of that song sounds like something I would have heard off of a country station down here in the old Mid-Ohio Valley. And that immediately made me go, oh my gosh, what am I getting into? Now the Sword have done flipped their shit. And then all of a sudden, like, the clouds part and the angels shine their heavenly light down, and they bring upon this tremendous stoner rock song that is probably one of the it is easily, in my opinion, the absolute best song off of this album. If you are not bobbing your head, like, within that first minute, and, like, playing air bass. I don't play air guitar on this song. I play air bass.
Oh, yeah.
I love it. My gosh, man. I cannot say I can't say much more other than this song is awesome.
This is that song that you just want to run out and share it with people. Like, listen.
Oh, absolutely.
Your life has been incomplete. You need to hear this song. And what hurts my soul, Robert Cooper, what cuts me deep is that there are a handful of people that I feel like their lives would benefit from hearing this song. They would be better people for hearing this song, and they just, you know, it's like, it's not their thing. But it's so good. Like, it should transcend a thing. It should transcend taste. It's that good. And it makes me sad that people don't see God in this song. When it stands before them and touches them on the shoulder and says, everything's going to be all right.
Oh, wow. We haven't oversold it, have we, Coop?
Yeah. I don't know if we're exaggerating or not.
I mean, like, I don't judge you for it.
Good.
It's pretty fun, though. I dug it. It's groovy as fuck.
Yeah.
Man.
You can't. You cannot avoid the groove in that song at all, man. It's so good.
Yeah, that's one where I could definitely, you know, I mean, it's no, I've wasted too much time fucking you that I would play it, you know, repeatedly from last year's Steel Panther. You know, it's not quite Anthem, but it's definitely repeat worthy. It's so good. It's a keeper. Let's move on to our next instrumental, that's what the kids call it. Our next instrumental of the Sword used future. This one is called Nocturne.
Thank you.
All right, man. Another pretty gloomy tune. You know, it. You know what I was thinking about when I was driving home? That was very typo negative sounding. Like, I'm listening to the song, and all I can hear is the dearly departed Pete Steele thinking, I wrote this song on the crapper about a girl. You know, it just, he did. He wrote one of the songs he made a point of telling us that he wrote while taking a shit.
Who is he, me?
I do my best work upon the throne. No, it sounded, Nocturne sounds very typo negative-ish. At least to me. I know, Jesse, you're not as familiar with typo negative, and the only thing Rob remembers about typo negative is I fell asleep during that podcast.
You did.
I really did. Hardcore, too.
Like, wow.
Long stretches of silence and a little bit of snoring. But anyway, Jesse.
I was snoring during the song, and I just thought somebody left the fan on.
All right, Jesse, what'd you think? What do you think of Nocturne?
Oh, Nocturne. And speaking of Nocturne, these guys, at least Mark Radulich is not nocturnal. That's for sure. He's got to be living by the daylight.
Living, I will tell you, after midnight.
That's not your song.
Working till the dawn.
Loving till the morning. And I'm gone. I'm gone.
Living after midnight.
All right, go ahead, Jesse.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Living after midnight.
Damn it! The sword. They say, listen, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, that last tune was great. All right, but we're throwing some more stuff at you that you may not be just as comfortable with as you were before, and that's, I think, a theme throughout this album. They make a point to show you that, okay, yeah, you like this tune. This is kind of what we were about, but here's some more of the stuff that we're getting into as we evolve as a band. 80s synth. I mean, there's some synthesizer all over this piece, and it's really just like you said, kind of ominous and. It's almost nostalgic in a way. It reminds me of, like, man, I watched Kung Fury, and the problem is that's a bad example because that was only done a few years back, but it was so 80s retro because of the synthesizer you heard throughout most of the half-hour show, the half-hour movie itself. That was on purpose to give you that 80s movie feel. That's kind of what I get here. Like, this is something that, you know, you see the hero walking off into the distance just as his partner got murdered. That's what it feels like. But, Coop?
Hold on.
He's still living after midnight.
Been working till the dawn.
He's getting ready for his hot date because he's going to get some hot stuff, baby, this evening. Want some hot stuff, baby, tonight.
Baby, tonight.
Robert.
I'm just going to hang out with a bunch of girls that aren't dating me. It's great.
Oh, all right.
Oh, you don't? Oh, I thought you were. I thought you had a hot date.
No. I'm just going out to drink with the girls.
You and the rest of the bitches, huh?
I mean, pretty much. It's a pretty cool group of bitches. And me.
Five dislikes on the YouTube channel.
Robin his gaggle of vaginas. 10 dislikes.
I was okay with the show up until the guy started talking about vaginas.
get back to saying this song is God.
It's like that time on the Three Beards where I said I'm not wearing pants, and somebody in the live chat went, "Welp, I'm out."
I'm not wearing any pants. Film at 11. All right, are you ready to? Should I just move on to the next song, there, Mr. Fancy Pants? Hey there, Fancy Pants.
Hold on. All right, I'm in the car now. We're good.
Terrific.
Nocturne. Fucking dug that song, man. Like, this album is one of those I didn't necessarily have a ton of hopes for it. As I, kind of heard bits and pieces of it, then I really felt like it picked up for me. Like, you know, I really started kind of getting what they were putting down, you know? picking it up, turning it all around, having fun.
Doing the hokey pokey with it.
Turn yourself
around.
That's
right. You know, that is one of my favorite really shitty jokes. When somebody goes, well, you know, that's what it's all about. I'm like, I thought that was the hokey pokey.
Oh, jeez.
I
cannot wait until Robert Cooper is a father. He has got so much practice at dad jokes. It's amazing.
Don't I?
Dude, I steal from you. I am the father of three kids. I steal from your single ass.
Do you really?
I do, sir.
Oh, I am flattered.
I'm sure that you had some inspiration in the Overtaker joke that I made to my daughter on the way to school a few days back. She goes, we're about to watch The Giver in class. I said, what's The Giver? And she goes, you don't know what The Giver is? I said, it's the opposite of The Taker. I said, is it the Overgiver? The opposite of The Undertaker? Is that what we're talking about here? That was a lame-ass joke. But damn, she's like, I'm out of here. Gets out of the car and then shuts the door on my face.
That's so great.
It's the Overgiver. I was like, that's Coop all. That's got Coop written all over it.
Oh, yeah. There's one who made a joke. It was, what was it? It was talking about short people and what are their nomenclature.
I can see where this is going.
I was like, wow.
Oh, that's awesome.
Or when he was... My sister was talking about Shakespeare, and he's like, oh, yeah, what is it? Like Midsummer Night's Dream. He goes, you got to be fucking kidding me.
Boo. Here's what I've noticed, at least with my own daughter, though from what you're saying, Jesse, this is pretty consistent. It's like, you as a dad, you could be stodgy, you could be serious, but like if you try to like have goofy fun with your kids, like your sons may be into it, they might be goofy too, but the daughters are just like, what are you doing?
They shut your shit down, dude. Everything
you're doing is embarrassing, but we're alone in the house. No, I'm mortified someone might be seeing through the walls. Like, everything you do as a dad is embarrassing no matter what you're doing.
It does not get any better, sir. I mean, as the young girls get older, we certainly, as fathers, do not get wiser, according to them.
All right.
Oh, man, I'm just going to get worse, because I have this problem of doubling down on this shit.
Oh, yeah, it's not like I stop. Like I said,
you continue it on purpose.
Yeah, I kicked open the door and no one else could hear the music I was listening. Dude, I make references nobody understands and I dance to music nobody can hear. That's how I live my life.
Oh, I do too. I just start like bebopping around and headbanging an air guitar and shit.
Shit at work. Like, you know, like I'm surrounded by inmates. Nurses are trying to, you know, book people in, and I'm just like wandering around the booking station, singing Hot Stuff by Mystic Prophecy, and dancing in front of inmates.
They're trying to book people and get dates.
Yeah, exactly. trying to avoid errant dick pics.
You know what's funny? Like the metal girl I've been talking to told me, I was like, yeah. I said, did you delete your profile? She goes, nah, I just unmatched you to clean my inbox up. I figure you got my number. What's it matter? I was like, oh, yeah? So what have you got on there? She goes, well, there's about 9 guys that have messaged me, and like, you know, we Snapchatted a little, and immediately all they did was send me their dick.
Of course.
Like, so, like 7 guys, dick pics.
Met her terrible.
I was like, so what about the other one? She goes, well, the other guy I don't really see his dating material. I said, why is that? He goes, well, he's really cool when we talk about music, but he has a neck, face, and back tattoo that all connect. And I kind of feel like that's just... he's just making bad life choices. Like, well, face tattoos tend to be the first one.
There's a lot of face tattoos where I work. All right, I'm going to go ahead and play... Speaking of being uncomfortable, I'm going to go ahead and play Don't Get Too Comfortable, and then I got a question for Jesse, the disapproving dad. So here we go. This is, as I said before, Don't Get Too Comfortable. We'll be right back. As much as I would have liked to have played more of that, unfortunately, we gotta move this along, you know, fair use and all. It's a great song. It's a very, very laid-back, groovy song. Lots, a little bit of funk to it. Definitely a lot of groove. Jesse Starcher.
Oh, yeah. This is probably one of the songs that I say has the most meaningful message off the album, I believe. I mean, it's easy to figure out what he's saying here, and it's just, you know, don't get too comfortable. You're in a position where everything could be going great, but just like that, things could change. And one of the things that I sent you guys a message on in our chat was, I honestly believe that this is a song to their old fans, the ones that are kind of grumpy that, you know, these guys have changed their sound. Listen, things change. Things happen. Bands
People
evolve.
People change.
Exactly.
Da, 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 da. Sorry.
What he's singing, that is right. Don't get too comfortable. You know, we could be looking at two albums on down the road, and the Sword could be doing something completely different than this. What could it be? I don't know. I like the direction they're going. I hope that they kind of, I'd love to see them bring some heavier stuff back, but either way, the song title says it all. Don't get too comfortable.
Ramblin' Man, Road Warrior, Robert Cooper, what's going on over there? Are you too comfortable?
Highway Man.
What am I rambling about? These nuts?
Yes, we're always rambling about these nuts.
The countryside?
Oh, God, country. Oh, country is the dirt fucking worst.
Jesse, all day yesterday, all I kept telling people was that, what's his face, is buried in Killarney.
Oh, shit. Jeez.
I was literally just throwing my hand in the air and just randomly yelling out, it's buried in Killarney.
What the hell?
Oh, man.
Don't worry about it. It's a Jesse and me's thing. See your way out of it.
Dude, the references. Which one was it where we were talking? It was me, you, and Ronnie when we were talking about, you know, you worked in a record store and
yeah,
you
that
made
was
this
the
one
that,
reference.
That was the Ministry review, yeah. And Coop
okay.
was there for that.
Okay, Coop was there.
Yeah.
All right. So your work family had to have felt exactly like us.
Oh, yeah. They have no idea what... They have no idea what the hell I'm talking about half the time, but I'm damn funny. So, you know, people are with it. I make them laugh. That's the important thing. You can sound like an insane person, but as long as you're not hurting anybody and you're funny, you can get away with it. That's what I've learned.
Oh,
Cooper,
okay.
second attempt. Don't get too comfortable. What'd you think?
I mean, I'm pretty damn funny. Oh, this song. Yeah, I mean... I like the song. Again, I wish I would have done a little more lyrical analysis, because I think Jesse's really on to something. Because I've noticed there are some bands that drastically change their musical stylings as they get older. Like Therion. They started as a death metal band. And this year they released a 3-hour rock opera.
Wow. That's different.
Yeah, I have not heard the new Therion yet.
It was 3 hours, and I'm like, oh, fuck that.
3 hours?
Yeah, it's called the, is it the Beloved Antichrist or something like that? Something
like that, yeah.
How do you spell that? Never mind, I found it.
Therion, Therion.
R-I-O-N.
Holy shit. There is 46 tracks. 46! Wow.
Yeah,
that sounds about right.
I mean, there's stuff like Asphyxiate with Fear is a really awesome song off there, one of their first albums. That's good shit. Yeah, it's really interesting to see some of those, like, you know, death metal bands that just kind of went either into like a gothic or like a power metal turn. Usually it's kind of gothic. I mean, look at Paradise Lost. That's an album called Gothic.
Jesse Starcher.
Yeah,
go ahead. Keep going, Coop.
I was just going to say, and with this band, they kind of went more of a... I mean, you can kind of smell some of that almost like a southern rock in some ways.
Yeah.
Maybe more of a... Well, I go with maybe more of a desert rock, kind of like a Caius. I like Kaya's. Kaya's a really good band.
One of the reviews I read compared one of the songs to Skynyrd. So I think you're onto something there, Coop.
Well, I'll tell you this. I know not this song in particular, but one of the earlier songs, I want to say it might have been like Sea of Green, I got a very Rush vibe from.
Mm-hmm. You can see the influences of bands like that, you know, all over the Sword. And what's funny, what's good about this is they bring them together and they lay it out for you in an album like this, take it or leave it if you like it or not. But you can feel those influences on it.
Yeah, there's one song on here later that does straight up. I was like, oh boy, I love Skynyrd. That's how I got kind of that idea of the Southern rock. Though I will say what does make me sad is when good death metal bands with good death metal logos, or even good stoner metal bands with good stoner metal logos, go legit and just lose like that cool logo. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Jesse, I'm gonna send you an article here in our music chat. It's up to you whether or not you want to discuss this.
Oh boy.
In the meantime, while I'm sending that to you, so my daughter and my son had their friends there, which are the neighbor kids in the house earlier, and one of the girls is special needs, so I think that's some of it. But I'm just curious if you go through this with your kids, where like one of their friends just wanders off into the house and goes into a bedroom. Like, not my bedroom or anything, but, you know, like, one of the other kids' bedrooms. She just wanders in there by herself. And it took me a second, and I realized the kid isn't in the living room anymore, but my two kids are. And I'm like, dude, where'd your friend go? Like, oh, she went into my room. And I'm like, And I'm like, hey, kid, you can't be in there unless one of my children are with you. And now Lily got up and went and joined her. But I was like, why is this happening? And again, it might be just the kid doesn't really know any better, but is this something that you have to deal with?
Yes. Well, yeah, I guess I would say. Not as much. We don't have too many kids over to the house very often. We do have a few friends of Caleb's that shows up every once in a while.
Well, I forget. You sit out on your front lawn now with the shotgun yelling, get off my lawn.
Mm-hmm. This is my property. My property.
I see that toilet paper. I'll put a bullet in your ass.
Get off my property. Yeah, every once in a while we'll have that. But, I mean, here lately, the kids that are coming over really don't know us a whole lot, so they kind of stick around in the living room in full view. But still, you're just we've had that in the past. Like, dude, the next-door neighbors that we lived by, you talk about getting comfortable. Well, I would have liked to have told them don't get too comfortable. Because they're in some, you know, they're in a room, they're downstairs, upstairs, wherever, and you're just like, well, who's keeping an eye on this kid? Why is he getting into shit? What's going on? The kids that we used to live by were horrible about that. I think it's just a matter of, do you know these kids? They come over a lot.
Yeah, they play with my kids every day.
Then that's probably why they just feel comfortable. Here is the question that you should probably ask me. If that was happening to me, would I like it? And the clear and definite answer is, fuck no. Stay in one room, keep your ass where I can see you. There you go.
I don't even want him in the house, quite frankly.
We'll agree with that too. I'm raising my hand. I agree.
They come over. They come over.
they do. They do come over. They come over. All right, speaking of coming over, here's our title track of this evening's proceedings. This is Used Future.
You.
dystopian used future. So if there's one song that screams Skinnerd vibe on this album, it's this one. Like, the vocals are very Skinnerd.
That guitar,
yeah.
The vocals.
Like, if you didn't know any better.
That guitar sounds straight up. Like, yeah, it just sounds straight. It sounds more Skinnerd than Skinnerd does right now.
Yeah, by far. Like, if you didn't know this was the... Sorry, I'm laughing at our chat.
Ronnie's upset.
Oh, God, what am I missing now?
Well, you're not in the chat, but... now is as good a time to bring this up as any. Before I do, though, because this is going to derail the podcast, do we have anything that we want to talk about as far as this very Skinnerd-esque title track, Used Future?
I do want to say I like this song a lot, and we missed an opportunity to cover this video because I didn't know it was out there. This was actually one of the videos that got released, and there is something going on. It isn't just lights and the lyrics coming up on the screen like we had with Twilight Sunrise. This song's video is set to a Final Fantasy video game. It's a theme. I should say theme. I don't want people to get excited and go, "Oh, set to a Final Fantasy game." No, it's a theme. Much like Chrono Trigger, the 8-bit or it should be the 16-bit. Excuse me, the 16-bit kind of graphics. It would look like something off Super Nintendo. But I'm telling you right now, it's Final Fantasy driven because there's they get in the fight with a bunch of robots. I believe it's the band in 16-bit form, and they get in the fight with a bunch of like robots. And there's the hit points and battles, and the crazy attacks and stuff like that. So I haven't had a chance to watch the whole video, but I caught like bits and pieces of it throughout listening to it today. And it looks really neat. I wish we would have covered that one on the Metal Hammer of Doom Extra.
Okay, so let's talk about this for just 1 second. A friend of mine posted an article. Assume it's not fake news. It's from Maxim.com. I mean, you know.
Oh, no.
Technically reputable? Headline.
Reputable-ish?
Ecosexuals are having sex with trees and nature to save the planet. We shamelessly hug trees, massage the earth with our feet, and talk erotically to plants.
All right, the first GIF. I don't even understand what this first GIF is. Just a guy and a lady dry humping air. Okay, that's all they're doing. They are dry humping air.
They're kind of touching the grass.
Sure. Well, they are. Okay, I'll give you that. They're squatting down and but that isn't the worst. The worst is third GIF down, but I'll let you go ahead and continue, Mark Radulich.
The wild world of sexual pleasures is a big, big place that is often very difficult to fully comprehend. There's one type of sexuality social movement you've probably never heard of before, ecosexuality, also known as sexicology. Make sure you talk about this tonight with your gaggle of vaginas, okay, Cooper? This is your.
I'll be there in a few.
By a loose, unofficial definition, ecosexuals are folks who get off to nature and believe they are helping the planet by having sex with it, like you do. They rub up on plants.
They believe they're helping the planet doing this?
They rub up on plants, roll around in dirt until they orgasm, have sex with trees, jerk off into or under waterfalls, etc., that sort of stuff. So here's my first problem with this.
The
plants can't give consent.
True.
Grow means grow.
Waka waka. And for a formal definition, the EcoSex Manifesto on the official sexicology website reads, "We are the ecosexuals. The earth is our lover. We are madly, passionately, and fiercely in love, and we are grateful for this relationship each and every day. In order to create a more mutual and sustainable relationship with the earth, we collaborate with nature. We treat the earth with kindness, respect, and affection." You know, 100 years ago, these people would have been locked away in an asylum.
I don't even know if they'd have made it that far.
"We make love with the earth. We are aquaphiles, terraphiles, pyrophiles, and aerophiles. We shamelessly hug trees, massage the earth with our feet, and talk erotically to plants. We are skinny dippers, sun worshippers, and stargazers. We caress rocks, are pleasured by waterfalls, and admire the earth's curves often. We make love with the earth through our senses. We celebrate our e-spots. We are very dirty. In other words, it's not Mother Nature.
How many
it's
more?
Lover Nature.
Come on. Yeah, give me some more puns. I want some more. I want more double entendres, please. Please.
But it's important to know that they are varying degrees of ecosexuality. Oh, good. It's a vast rainbow. Where the mild end of the spectrum includes things like using coconut oil as a sustainable alternative to lube. Good to know. Using crystal dildos, walking around naked, and going skinny dipping. Well, if walking around naked makes you an ecosexual, then I've been one for a very long time.
He is very ecosexually active with himself.
Yeah. On the other, more extreme end of the ecosex spectrum, people literally have sex with trees and logs and vegetables and whatnot. Finger plants.
And whatnot.
Finger plants. And flowers.
Oh my God.
Get married to vegetation, oceans, and celestial bodies and do dirty stuff to dirt in an effort to show the earth some love and save the planet. Yeah, there's a lot. Again, though, none of this stuff can give consent, so wouldn't it be rape? They're raping the earth?
I mean, Pee Wee Herman married an egg salad sandwich, didn't he?
Did he really?
Oh no, was it potato salad? It was that joke of, you love it so much, why don't you marry it? He goes, maybe I will.
Terrific.
And then he does.
This is why the Muslims will win.
Darka.
Seven dislikes.
You know, I have to wonder if people will listen to this, start to type a comment, and then hear me laughing at the fact that we're making fun of whatever possible negativity is going to come out of this, and just going, why bother? There's no talking to this asshole.
One can hope.
We talk out of our assholes all the time on this show.
This is very true. If you're terribly confused as to how boning an oak tree or rubbing potting soil on your crotch will help the environment in any way at all, let
not
me...
comfortable. That does not sound comfortable
at all. Don't get too comfortable with that potting soil. Let me assure you that I, too, am not sure I understand the thought process behind this. I'm trying, though. I really am. I mean,
You know, swamp ass has now become a sexual comment. Swamp ass. Swamp ass.
Were you referring to the gif?
Pretty much most of my nights.
Were you referring to the gif of the person who looks to be giving oral pleasure to the bush?
No. There is a... It's the third gif down, I believe, where she is... It's right above that one.
Okay.
I didn't even see the... What is she doing? She is straight up, like, got her face...
Oh, that's where you got that from. Okay, so Coop, you can't see it, but this woman is, like, covered in pollen, and there's a comment underneath that says, Pollen Bukkake, anyone. Please, someone start a band called Pollen Bukkake.
I mean, we have everything else.
Dude, all I can do is look at that picture and just think of the horrible allergic reaction that I would have having pollen dumped on my face. That's all I can think of. It's because I would start sneezing, and this girl obviously enjoys it. She's having a good time.
You know, look, I don't begrudge people their happiness, you know, and I kid about the whole, you know, consent thing, I guess. But like I said, when the Red Chinese invade America, we don't stand a chance. We're gonna be too busy fucking trees.
A bunch of fucking hippies out there.
We will have come and gone. That's what we will have done.
Boom!
Boom!
Still got it.
Waka waka.
Good thing you didn't blow your load with that joke.
You messaged Jesse during that song, "Oh My God, the Skinnerd." Yeah, that was like a Skinnerd Pink Floyd hybrid.
Yeah. That's another band that you mentioned that does feel like this is heavily influenced by. When you listen to Dark Side of the Moon, which is by far probably the most popular Pink Floyd album, there are, if I remember correctly, there are a few instrumentals on there, and or just, you know, them playing and the girls singing in the background or whatever. That resonates throughout Used Future, in my opinion. So, again, 70s influence, man. It's good stuff. I'm a fan of Floyd, by the way. So, Coop?
Oh, yeah. That really did sound like kind of the baby between the two of them. I really enjoyed it, though. Again, a lot of this album really grew on me as I listened to it. Really, I feel like it really would reward repeat listens.
Indeed.
Where the fuck am I going? I fucking hate downtown. All right. God damn.
All right, this next one's a really, really good track. This one is Book of Thoth. It's a short one there, but you know, for a short song, it's awfully good, awfully, awfully good. We got one more track to go. We'll get to it momentarily. Give me your thoughts on the Book of Thoth.
Book of Thoth. What the hell is a Thoth? I'd love if it would have been a Star Wars reference, and it would have been the Book of Hoth.
Dude, I got a friend that lives in New York, and I mean, you I'm sure sympathize with this. You living in the Rust Belt. But they've been hit by a couple of nor'easters and just buried into, like, 10 feet of snow. And so every time I call them, just like, hey, did you ride your Tauntaun to work today? I'm always teasing him. And, you know, and his one comeback, though, is just like, okay, you know, I'll call you back during hurricane season, asshole. I'm like, all right, maybe a hurricane hits me, maybe it doesn't, but you definitely got hit by 3 nor'easters.
One right after the other, nonstop. Yeah, I dug, again... This is a great track. It's not the best in my opinion, but it's still fun to listen to. It rounds out. I think this is it. This is the last track with some vocals, right?
I'm not sure.
I think Brown Mountain is just instrumental as well, and then Reprise is just a few tracks, I believe. But we'll find out here in a few minutes. Regardless,
why don't you believe? Sorry.
Regardless, it is it's a great way to end out the songwriting. If this is the last bit of vocals that we get to hear, I'm perfectly fine with it. Coop?
Yeah, I thought it was a really groovy song. I like that they kind of brought the distortion back a little bit. It was pretty fun song. I enjoyed it.
All right, let's call it then. We got let's go ahead and listen to Brown Mountain, and then we'll give our final thoughts, and we'll get out of this piece. So here we go. Don't know what you're laughing about there, giggles, but. Mm-hmm. Alrighty. That about does it here for our coverage of Used Future from the Sword. I'm going to give this a solid A. I really, really dug this. I, you know, is it the most metal? Obviously not. I mean, we kept referencing like Rush and Skinner and Pink Floyd and whatnot. But, you know, as far as song construction, as far as riffs that really get into your bones and your soul, mission accomplished. I really, really dug it. I if this is the direction the Sword is going, I am along for the ride. Take me with you, Sword, wherever you may roam. Jesse?
Yes, Sword. The Sword Used Future. Not as offensive to me as High Country was. Okay, I came from Apocryphon to High Country, and I was really let down. Now, we go into Used Future, and again, I was worried. I was concerned. Am I going to get more of that? Am I going to be that let down again? And I wasn't. Initially, I was scared after the first listen. Mark Radlich says, this is a damn good album. And I said, pshaw, right?
You,
I don't think so,
you
dude.
Pretentious snob, you.
This is the Metal Hammer of Doom, after all. Where are you coming from? Judas Priest Firepower. Remember that album? But the thing is that after repeat listens, this will grow on you. I it is a great album to just put on and do whatever you want to do and catch it in between whatever you're doing and maybe even dance while you're vacuuming the floor like I was yesterday. I was doing it. My wife was dancing to this album. She was getting down.
Nice.
And yeah, so it that says a lot. So this is an album that deserves praise in my opinion. And I think a lot of people pulled the trigger just like I did right at the beginning and said, this is such a departure. Oh my gosh, man. Gods of the Earth, dude. The Freya. See, now that was mistitled on a YouTube video, and now I'm calling it the Freya. Freya. Freya, man. You know, this is it's that's not them anymore. Just like Clutch is not Pitchfork when we used to hear that way back in the beginning. Shogun named Marcus. I mean, we're at a point in life where you can say a band can evolve, and this band is in the process of doing that. Don't get too comfortable, okay? Don't do it. By the way, it's making number three. It's knocking Avatar Country down just under Judas Priest. Goes the Sword out of the 13 albums that we have covered so far this year.
Outstanding. Coop.
God damn, I fucking hate Downtown. Fuck!
Terrific.
What a glowing review.
I had to pack my way out of something that's fucking public parking when it's for a fucking hotel. God damn it.
First of all, sir, don't drive angry. Second of all, you want to... The rest of us aren't going on your date with multiple women. Could you please give your thoughts on the album, sir?
Hold on. Almost done turning. Okay.
Just a minute.
Oh, okay. I can park right there. Oh, fuck me, run. All right. Okay. Anywho, this album, you know, just like we were talking about, it really does grow on you. It's like The Clap. I mean, you kind of... I mean, you know, it's a real good time. You won't regret it, even though maybe you will in the morning. I don't know. I'm not a good judge of that stuff. So, yeah. Fun album. It's one of those... I would kind of look past preconceived notions and stuff that you really know about the band and just give the album a try, man. I give it a solid 4 out of 5. It's a fun one. It's a grower. And, I mean, there's tons of groovy songs that are on it. So... give it a listen.
All right. Now, we got, speaking of treats, we got a real treat for you next week here on the Metal Hammer of Doom and the Rattlegion Broadcasting Network. We are going to review the very first power metal album. What is it? Metal something or other for a mortal man?
Oh, I'd tell you, but I don't remember either.
Well, we're very excited about the project. Hang on.
This is Power Glove.
Yes, Power Glove. Metal Combat for the Mortal Man. We are going to go in the Wayback Machine And the reason why we're doing that for you is it's video game week every day, all week long here on the Metal Hammer of Doom. We got a source material for the first six issues of Injustice, which of course came out of the video game. We've got our Damn You Hollywood, Hollywood if she could, review of Ready Steady Go, Ready Player One. And then as the aforementioned Power Glove, Metal Combat for the Mortal Man. And then we're going to do an on-trial for the movie Tron. Not Tron Legacy, but the original 1980s Disney classic Tron. So go ahead and tune into all that mess. We've got... now, Jesse, when can we... Jesse's been putting up some of the old... something old, something new, something blue, and something used. We got some old Metal Hammer of Dooms that are going to go into the rebroadcast pile here on Spreaker. Jesse, what's in store for us? What do you got going on?
Right now, it just got uploaded, so you're going to get a dual shock of Metal Hammer of Doom. One of those broadcasts is this one right here that you're listening to right now, and then another one reaching all the way back in the archives from 2014. We have grabbed the Baby Metal album review. So, and we also have on tap at some point here, we will get the Metal Resistant Baby Metal album up as well. So you'll be... Here's the thing. I'm testing the hypothesis that if I put hashtag Baby Metal in the tags, we're going to get some listens, because apparently that works, according to what we see. And, of course, there is the other thing that, hey, guys, we're not so hard on the beaver here. We think Baby Metal's okay. Check out the reviews and listen to them. You might just understand that we're fans too.
I think the question really becomes, when will we stop talking about this?
Give it a month. We might get over it. But I tell you what, if the rebroadcast of Baby Metal skyrockets, I mean, listen, we have 180 some listens on our America Cacant right now, okay? And that was, I don't know how long of an album that we, you know, that was a long podcast. We went probably about 2 hours or so. And then Rob Halford, Baby Metal, Metal Hammer of Doom Extra has 156 listens and probably that many comments, if not more. So there is something there. We just got to find the right, sack to tickle, Mark Rattles.
Right.
We're going to tickle a sack, you know, and get some listens.
That's right. We're tickling the bag of America. That's what we do here in the Metal Hammer of Doom. All right, speaking of tickling a bag, Robert Cooper, go ahead and do your plugs. Or not.
Is he there?
Jesse Starcher, finish your plugs.
Ladies and gentlemen, go give the Rattlitch in Broadcasting Network Facebook page a like to stay up on top of all the great podcasts that we have to offer. We talk MMA, we talk comics, we talk movies. We also talk TV shows every once in a while. So there is something most likely that you'd like to listen to on the network. We're at home on Spreaker. Spreaker, ladies and gentlemen, not Blog Talk Radio anymore, Spreaker. Check us out there. We're on all sorts of platforms, iTunes, TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, ladies and gentlemen. You can find us there as well. If you'd like to follow me on Twitter, you can do so at Stiznarchy. Source Material does a podcast on here, and I'm a part of it, and that is a comic book, what would we say, book club. That's probably the best way to put it, where we discuss all sorts of fun comic book storylines that have come out. It's called the Source Material Podcast. There's something on there. 150-some episodes. He made it.
Terrific.
Hooray. And we're almost at the end of the podcast. That's it. I turn it over to somebody here, whoever's going next.
Hey. Metal.
All right. Are you going to do any plugs or say anything before you walk into the bar, or do you just want to tell us to fuck off and let's get on with this?
Metal.
Terrific. All right, folks. Tomorrow night on the Rattle and Broadcasting Network, the Screaming Boy podcast returns with the rise and fall of Toys R Us, a panel discussion. We'll get that done. It'll be fantastic. We might have a treat for you Friday night. Me and the Harumphy Hump, Ronnie Adams. We might be doing a little commentary. We're not sure yet. We'll see what happens. I know people have been asking when the new commentary is coming out. You know, when we have time, when you do three and four shows a week, it's a little hard to get the stuff scheduled.
It is. It's tough.
But we might get a commentary out there for you. It'll be fun if we do. The other thing is, look for some more Metal Hammer of Doom extras on YouTube and on the Spreaker account. We might do some for Power Glove to promote the next Metal Hammer of Doom, and we'll just keep that train rolling. All right, speaking of trains rolling, that's Jesse Starcher. He was Robert Koop, the Metal Koop. I am your host, the Mandated Reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Rattledge. This has been the Metal Hammer of Doom. Be well, be safe, and behave.